Good morning, children. We are going to start another video lesson of class 12 biology, the same chapter evolution, and today we are going to discuss about the different theories of evolution, and this is part 4. Okay, so let us start. Children, the theories of evolution mainly were given by different scientists, that how evolution took place, that is how the organisms got modified themselves, they modified themselves to survive in the environment in which they lived. Now the certain theories which you have in your syllabus and which we will be discussing, first we will be talking about them in very little, just in two sentences, and then we'll take the details of each one of them. The first one is the Lamarck's theory of inheritance of acquired characters. Now, as from the name you can understand that this was given by Lamarck, okay? Jean Baptiste de Lamarck. And as it was given by Lamarck, that's why this theory is also known as Lamarckism. Now, Lamarck told that in the lifetime of an organism acquires many characters. And these acquired characters are inherited, that is, they are transferred to the offspring. This is all about Lamarck's theory. Next, we have Darwin's theory of natural selection. What did Darwin tell? First of all, this was given by Charles Robert Darwin, and that's why this is also known as Darwinism. And what he told, that there are different variations which occur. Variations means minor differences which take place in each generation, and these small variations, how much they are selected by nature, means how the nature selects those organisms which are better, which better survive with those variations. They are the so they are best selected by the nature and they survive, and these variations are transferred into the next generation. Next comes the mutation theory. Mutation theory tells about the sudden mutations which occurred in any organism, and because of these mutations evolution took place in different organisms, and this was given by Hugo de Vries. And the last theory is the modern theory, or the synthetic theory, or the neo-Darwinism. This is a modified version of the Darwin's theory, and this is the most accepted one, and we'll talk about this in detail later on. Okay, so let us go to the first theory is Lamarckism, that is the Lamarck's theory. Now this theory of Lamarck, that is theory of inheritance of acquired characters, was given by Jean Baptiste de Lamarck. Now what did Jean Lamarck told was that the changes in structure or functions of any organ acquired during the lifetime of an individual in response to the changes in the surrounding environment, okay, in the surrounding environment, inherited by the offspring, and keep on adding up over a period of time. Means what, in short, they are trying to tell, Lamarck wanted to tell, was that all the characters which are acquired in a lifetime by an organism are transferred into the next generation, okay. Now comes the postulates of the theory. What were the small salient features or propositions given by Lamarck? The first one was new needs. Now what does this new needs refer to? The environment always influences all types of organism. Environment influences the organisms which are present there. A change in the environment brings about changes in the organism. Any change in the environment gives changes in the organisms. Now it gives rise to new needs also. When new changes are there, new needs also arise. These new needs are actually the desires, produce new structures. Because of these new needs which have arisen in the environment, what happens? New structures are produced, and change, or the habits of the organisms change because of these new needs. So what are new needs? New needs are actually changes in the environment which create the new want for different things. This is new needs. What is the next postulate given? It is use and disuse of organs. Now, what is this use and disuse of organs mean? Now, if an organ is constantly used, it would be better developed, whereas when an organ is not used too much, it is generally results in its degeneration. What does this mean actually? It is actually new habits involve greater use of certain organs. Okay, we know the organ which we are more using will be more used. Okay, they are means used in a more better way, and in rapid fashion they are used. The new habits involve greater use of certain organs to meet the new needs, and the lesser ones, what happens generally, these organs are degenerate. The continuous use of organs and organs keep them functional. Whenever too much of use of any organ occurs, it becomes very much functional and makes them stronger and more efficient. But continuous disuse when the organ is not used too much, or organs are not used too much, generally there is gradual reduction in their size, and also they finally disappear. So this is use and disuse of organs. Okay, so in case of this giraffe, if we take the example, evolution of giraffe, what were their new needs? The change in the environment. What was the change in the environment? That is, the lower vegetation was going away, and only the leaves of the top plant, the leaves which are at the top of the plant, were there. So this was a new need. What was the use and disuse of organs all about? Here, when the leaves only of the top part of the plant were there, naturally, what was the need which arose? That is, they have to reach to the top part of the plant to have food. Now, due to this new need, what organs were used too much? The forelimbs of the giraffe as well as the neck was used. Okay, so they stretched their forelimbs, they also stretched their neck. So use and disuse of organs. Now what happened in the next postulate, that is a proposition which was given, was the inheritance of acquired characters. What happened? Whatever an individual acquires, okay, whatever an individual acquires to possess, that is, acquires means to possess characters in its lifetime due to internal vital force or the effect of environment, or it is of new needs. There is use and disuse of organ because of these new needs, and they are inherited, or these organs are used continuously, they become too much functional, and these are inherited into the next generation. This process continues and continues. Okay, this little bit of functionality increases of the organs, and this is passed into the next generation. Again, functionality increases, whichever is present, again it is passed to the next generation. So what happens? There is, after several generations, what is seen? A variation is seen which accumulates. Variations means certain differences are seen from the original organisms, and this continues to continues to accumulate. Now what happens? Speciation occurs. Speciation means it means that new species arise from the older ones, that is, origin of new species from the older ones. When these variations, which has occurred generation after generation, and it has been inherited also generation after generation, they accumulate and thus lead to a completely new species after several generations, which is much more different from the older one, from where evolution has taken place. Okay, so these were the postulates which was given by Lamarck's theory of inheritance of acquired characters, that is Lamarckism. Now there were some examples which were supporting Lamarckism. What were the examples? For example, evolution of the long neck of giraffe. What was seen? That the ancestors of the giraffe were bearing a small neck, okay, and very small forelimbs were there, like horses or like donkeys, which we see now. But as they were living in places with no surface vegetation, what happened? They had to stretch their neck and forelimbs, and to take the leaves of the top part of the plant, trees, for food, which resulted in slight elongation of these parts. These parts means the front forelimbs, the forelimbs as well as the neck. Whatever they acquired in one generation, whatever little bit of enhancement was there in the forelimb as well as in the neck of the giraffe, that was in one generation, that was transmitted into the next generation, with the result that the race of the long-necked and long-forelimbed animals was developed. Now that much was transferred into the next generation. In the next generation, a little bit enhancement was there, and thus speciation, or a new variety or new species, resulted. Now, some other examples which are given are of webbed toes of aquatic birds. Now, what this was, that aquatic birds like ducks have been evolved from terrestrial ancestors actually. What they are trying to tell here in this example is that aquatic birds like ducks, swans, and these geese have arisen from the terrestrial ancestors. Now, how did this webbed feet, you know that aquatic birds have webbed feet. Now, how did this web develop between the toes? In these birds, this was an adaptation to aquatic mode of life. What happened? Web developed because the ancestral swarms had to spread their toes continuously. They used to spread their toes, and the skin in between the toes stretched, which helped them to wade in the water, and hence resulted in the webbed foot of the aquatic birds. Also, their size of the wings also reduced because they did not use the wings too much for flying. Okay, they always remained in water, and they used their feet for moving around. Now, one more example which can be given, you can see in the slide, is disappearance of the limb of the snakes. Not only means snakes means like boas and all, pythons and boas. According to Lamarck, what happened? The ancestors of snakes. According to them, the ancestors of snakes were actually lizard-like. They lived in the thick jungles, and out of fear of the mammals, these ancestors of snakes started creeping. Means, rather than running, creeping was much easier, and it was very fast. Okay, on the forest floor or the jungle floor. Now, this creeping, for this creeping and burrowing, they stretched their body, which gradually became elongated. The body became elongated, and there was no use of those small limbs which were present there in the body. And they were a form of obstruction for their moving pattern. Okay, so what happened? Those limbs finally, slowly, they disappeared in the snakes and these, that is, pythons and the boas. Okay. Now, coming to the flightless birds. Flightless birds means the ancestors of the birds, that is, we are talking, we can take an example of ostrich, were capable of flying. They were capable of flying, but due to some environmental factors, what happened? They had plenty of food nearby. So, they did not have to move from one place to another in search of food. And they were well protected also. So, what happened? This led to, they did not fly to distant places, and they do not. There was no need of moving to distant places. Because of which, what happened? Their wings were not of so much use, and which became vestigial later on in these in the form of these flightless birds. One more example was evolution of feet in horse and deer. What happened in case of horse and deer? The ancestors, deers and horses, were not having so much speed in running. Okay, they were slow runners. Now, what happened? But as they needed protection from other animals, now many predators came, and they needed some protection from the other animals of that time. So they started running. But due to the presence of those other units in their feet, what happened? They produced hindrance for running. That's why ultimately what happened, only the third toe was long, and the other toes or the digits were in the form of splint bones, which we talked earlier in the this evidences of evolution, isn't it? So these were some of the examples which were in support of Lamarck's theory. Let us go into the next slide, which shows the criticism against Lamarckism. Now, what this criticism of Lamarckism was all about, that first and foremost criticism came from August Weismann. Okay, Weismann was the first person who criticized. August Weismann is the same person who gave the theory of continuity of germplasm. And what was this continuity of germplasm all about? Weismann told that the characters influencing the germ cells are only inherited. Means whatever characters are there in the germ cells are only inherited. That is, there is continuity of germplasm, that is protoplasm of the germ cells. Germplasm means what? Protoplasm of the germ cells, but not of the somatoplasm. Somatoplasm means what? The protoplasm of the somatic cells was not transmitted to the next generation. Hence, it did not carry characters to the next generation. So, what did Weismann, he performed an experiment to judge the exact thing about the inheritance of acquired characters. He cut the tails of rats. Okay, he took two rats maybe, and he cut the tails of those two rats. Now, what he did, he let them breed. for means he let them breed, and naturally when they bred, they gave birth to small offsprings again. Now the small offsprings, and before cutting the tail of the rat, the parent generation's tail was measured, that is, what is the length of the tail. Now what happened, the first the parent gave birth to the first generation. Now when the first generation rat grew up, he measured the tail of the rat. It was same as that of the parent rat in the first generation. It was same. Now like this, he continued cutting the tail for the first generation, then for the second generation. Breeding continued like this. He performed for 22 generations, and he allowed them to breed. And in the new generation, whenever the new generation came, he always measured their tails to see that there is any reduction, because tail, if it's not present in the rats from the parent generation to the 21st generation, it should be reduced or it should be vestigial. But no such thing occurred, and the length of the tail was same as the first generation's tail of the which came into the existence that time. So it was proved that cutting of the tails means, if because rats, the first rat, first two rats which underwent the cutting of tail, that was acquired character in their lifetime, but that was not transmitted into the offsprings which were present after 22 generations. It was not carried forward. So this was the first criticism. This other criticisms another criticism came from Pavlov. Pavlov, have you know that in class 10 you have studied about Pavlov's in class 11 also you have studied rather about that dogs, he performed this conditioned reflex. When the bell rings, the dogs salivates, isn't it? We studied that. Now what happened, Pavlov did this experiment, the dog which he trained, okay, now trained that whenever he used to ring the bell, if the food is there or not, the dog starts salivating. Now this was acquired character in the dog. Now that dog was the dog's bred, and the offsprings which came, when the bell ring, those offsprings of the first generation did not salivate. What was the proof? That it was acquired character in the parent generation, but this was not transmitted into the offsprings. So again, a negative point for the Lamarckist or Lamarckism theory of acquired characters. Now, in the next, Wessler's muscles. It was seen that the Wessler's powerful muscles are not transmitted to the offspring. It was acquired character in its lifetime, but it was not transmitted. In case of Chinese women, what was seen? Chinese women, you know that they wear, whenever they are born, after a few years, they wear iron shoes so as to keep their feet very small. What it is considered in case of Chinese women, if their feet is very small, it is considered as a sign of beauty. So what was done, that Chinese women who wore shoes, iron shoes, to keep their feet small, this is an acquired character in the lifetime, but it was not inherited into their offsprings. So one more is given in the slide. You can see boring of pinna, that is ear and nose boring of pinna and nose in Indian women, which is done. It is an acquired character in the lifetime, but it is not transmitted into the offsprings of the who come in the next generation. So these were all the criticism of Lamarckism which were given by different scientists, and these were the proofs that this theory is not at all working. Okay, so in the next slide we'll go into the next theory of evolution, which is, and children, one more thing, do not confuse between the theories, because the previous theories which we studied at the starting, they were theories of origin of life, that is special creation and abiogenesis, all these things, and now we are studying theories on evolution. Okay, now Darwinism, what was all about Darwinism? Darwin major means, what did Darwin first do, and by whom he was inspired about? Okay, now Darwin was inspired by Thomas Robert Malthus. Okay, Thomas Robert Malthus, he put forward a theory on human population growth, and what it is, and this theory he put forward in his book of which was written by Malthus. It is an essay on principles of population. What did Malthus tell? Malthus, he stated that population grows geometrically, okay, when it is unchecked, whereas the means of subsistence, that is the food and all these things, they grow only, that is food, space, all these, they are limited, and they only grow arithmetically. So this was the proposition given by Malthus. And it is told naturally means naturally after some time in imbalance would occur, because there, if there is too much of rise in population and limited resources are there, naturally people will die due to hunger, epidemics and all other things, earthquakes. Means it was told that whenever there is imbalance, some other factors take over, that is floods, epidemics, earthquakes start and people are again, means the normal number of population size again is restored. So such population crash is called catastrophic control of population, and these factors were called as positive checks by Malthus. Now what happened how Darwin was influenced by this? Now Darwin, he went for a voyage, okay? He went for a voyage in 1831. I told the name of the ship. Do you remember that? HMS Beagle, remember? So now when I was talking about Darwin's finches. Now in 1831, he went on a voyage on his HMS Beagle and he sailed around the world, okay? And while he was sailing around the world, he went to different islands, different continents. He saw the, explored all the flora and fauna there. He also later, this beagle was landed into the Galapagos Island, okay? And Galapagos Island, where he saw different kinds of finches, okay? Different kinds of birds. Galapagos Island, I told you, it is in the west coast of South America, in the Pacific Ocean. When he reached there, he saw the different kinds of finches. Then he returned, okay? Then Darwin returned in 1836. He returned, and then after 5 years, he returned. He came across the book of this Malthus, that is Robert Malthus, and he was inspired by that. So he gave some propositions on this theory of natural selection, which was known as the theory of natural selection. And this theory of natural selection, in gist, it is that what does this natural selection tell? That nature selects whoever is going to survive and whoever will not be surviving. Now, what was the first proposition given by, or salient feature given by Darwin? It was rapid multiplication or overproduction. Overproduction or rapid multiplication is the first proposition which was given. Now, what is all about that one? That all organisms possess enormous fertility. Okay, enormous fertility is there for each and every organism, and they multiply in geometric ratio. Now, if I'm going to explain this rapid multiplication or overproduction, take for example bacteria. You know that bacteria multiply in every 20 minutes. Now, if all the conditions are optimum, all the conditions optimum means there is no problems around in the environment in which the bacteria is multiplying, then this number in within 24 hours means if the single bacterium reproduces, it will be nearly 4.7 into 10 to the power 27 bacteria weighing about 2000 tons in this earth, okay? So it will be a huge number. Similarly, paramecians, if they are allowed to, they generally divide three times in 48 hours. So what will happen in 5 years? The means number of paramecium would completely means surround the whole earth. It will be nearly equal to 10,000 times of the mass of the earth. So imagine how much overproduction would be there if all the conditions are optimum. Please keep in mind that one. Okay. So overproduction is always there. Rapid multiplication is always there. But in all organisms, the same rate of multiplication or overproduction is not there. For example, in elephants, it is very less. Elephant is considered as the slowest breeder, okay? And this difference in reproduction rate is known as differential reproduction. Differential reproduction. So this was the first proposition given. The second proposition was limited food and space. Now, what do you mean by limited food and space? Space always, despite of rapid multiplication, food and space always and other resources remains constant. They don't increase. They are in arithmetic pattern. That is, I think, hope you understand geometric pattern and arithmetic pattern. For example, geometric pattern means what? 2 into 2 into 2 into 2 is equal to 16. And if I take it in arithmetic pattern, then 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2, then it comes to 8. So it is half of it. Arithmetic pattern is half of it. Now what happens? Space in the universe is always constant, and the ultimate source of food for the plants and animals also remains constant. Therefore, the carrying capacity of the environment does not allow the population to grow indefinitely. So indefinite growth will not be there because other limiting factors are there, because food, space, all these are limiting factors. So they will not be growing tremendously. It will be checked. Now, the next one is the struggle for existence. There are three types of struggle for existence. The intraspecific, that is within the species. Interspecific struggle, which is between two species, which is mainly predation, predator-prey relationship. And environmental struggle, which is due to the environmental factors which is around. Okay. Now, struggle of existence means what? What happened? According to Darwin, which were the resources like space, air, food, water, these minerals and light on the earth, which are all limited. But the number of organisms increases manifold due to overproduction. Now, there is intense competition and threefold struggle for existence amongst the organisms for obtaining maximum amount of resources. Now, who will be able to exist after this struggle will be surviving? After all this struggle, who will be existing will be surviving. Now, Darwin also gave another, the fourth feature, that is variations. What are these variations all about? Now, variations, we know that small differences between organisms are called variations. No, you have studied already that variations are small differences, means no two organisms are similar. That is, except monozygotic twins, no two organisms are identical. They are not similar. Though they are also in their habits and all these forms, they are also not similar. They are also different. But features-wise, they are identical. So, it means that there are differences among individuals which are called variations. Variations are the law of nature, and these variations may be beneficial or harmful. Always these variations go on continuously in a population. Small differences are always seen because of recombination and all these things. Different variations, some are harmful, some are neutral, or some are beneficial, are seen in the population. So, according to Darwin, these variations are very continuous and gradual, and these help, which were helpful in the adaptation of the organism. These variations occur why? Because they are in adaptive in nature. They help the organisms to adapt to the surroundings. Now, next one, postulate which was given was natural selection or survival of the fittest. Actually, natural selection term was given by Darwin, and survival of the fittest was given by Wallace. Okay. Now, organism with favorable variations would survive because they are the fittest to face the surroundings and hence selected by nature. Now, the ones who are best fitted, who are best fitted to the environment in which they are living, will be selected by the nature. Nature will select them as the best one. They will survive and the rest will die. For example, to explain this phenomenon, let me take an example. You know about the extinct reptiles, right? That is the dinosaurs. During the evolution of the reptiles, giant reptiles, that is the dinosaurs, etc., also appeared. Majority of these dinosaurs were herbivores, but due to certain climatic changes, the vegetation also disappeared. Therefore, what happened? Most of them became extinct. However, the small animals who were at that time would change their feeding habits from herbivorous to carnivorous diet, and they survived because they could easily get adapted to the changed environment. These therefore would survive more and hence were selected by nature. Okay, that's why they were able to survive, because they were selected by nature because of their adaptive features. Darwin called it as natural selection. Okay. Now, this natural selection is always survival of the fittest, means who is able to survive will survive in the environment, others will die. Now, when these survival of the fittest part came, this survival of the fittest, or the nature selects the ones with favorable variations, means those organisms who had favorable variations, who had favorable features, would survive. And these favorable variations, which would naturally be transmitted to the next generation, there came the next postulate, that is inheritance of these useful variations. Because of the presence of the useful variations, the organisms were able to survive in the environment. That is, nature selected them. So, these variations will be transmitted into the next generation. No useful ones, and all the unuseful ones or the non-useful ones will be eliminated. So, inheritance of the useful variations took place. Next came the formation of new species. Now, what happened when these good variations are there in the organisms? New variations appear in every generation. We know that small variations are there in every generation, which continuously accumulates, and thereafter a number of generations, after a number or number of generations, a completely new species is formed. Now, what is all that about? Variations keep on accumulating, and after a number of generations, what happens? The offsprings become markedly different, forming a new species. That is, origin of new species occurs by gradual modification of the older one, which is known as speciation. So here are the four salient features of Darwin's theory of natural selection or Darwinism, that is, rapid multiplication or overproduction, limited food and space, struggle for existence, variations, that is, small differences, natural selection or survival of the fittest, favorable variations would survive, others will get eradicated. Inheritance of those useful variations in the next generation and formation of the new species would occur ultimately by the accumulation of different useful variations after several generations. I would talk about some criticisms also. In Darwinism, what was told is that he gave so many postulates, there were some criticisms given, like, for example, these variations which came in different organisms. Many scientists put forward that variations are there that Darwin told, but how did these variations come into the scene? Nothing was told about that, what mutations occurred or what occurred that these variations came. Nothing was told about all these things. Darwin also did not tell anything about the vestigial organs. Okay, how did these vestigial organs disappear? Or if they were present, why they are not used for the possessor? All these things came into the scene. Over-specialization was one more thing. Tusks of elephants and the antlers of deer, they are over-specialized organs in animals. And this beyond the stage of usefulness rather than causing hindrance in daily life cannot be explained by natural selection theory. This over-specialization of some of the organs of the animals were not explained very clearly. That's why this theory was not taken into consideration for long, and the next theory came into the scene, that is the mutation theory, which was put forward by Hugo de Vries. We'll take this up in the next video lesson. This is all for today, children. Go through the through these two theories very nicely. Lamarckism, all the postulates, as well as Darwinism, all the postulates. I'll meet you very soon with the next class. Thank you for today.